Boot fans, welcome on in. I'm Brian. We've got Rich here with us today.
Good evening, everyone.
And this is our second episode of Boots and Bantz. We've decided to stick with the name Boots and Bantz. We had some suggestions, including Denny on YouTube. Thanks for throwing in your suggestion, Denny. He said Boot Monday, which would have worked because we're going to do this in a weekly event, as a weekly event, and it's going to be a Monday. And we talk about boots, but... Okay, but that was a good suggestion. we're not gonna go with that one, right? We're going with Boots and Bantz. Well, let's kick it off. The first thing we want to talk about, and we're gonna get right into it right here, is we want to talk about the Nike Superfly CR7 that was released this week. I'm sure you've got to see them, Rich.
I have seen them in just a brief Vine clip on the weekend while I was at work, but luckily. I've seen pictures in the interim basis coming through, so.
Oh, nice. Yeah, there are a few knocking around the place. I've got one right here that I'm going to pull up for us to check out.
See what we got.
Yes. So we got good old Cristiano running in his boots right here. So here's an action shot. Let's see them.
They're nice. On the page. They are a nice looking pair of boots.
Yeah, let's bring up the other one that actually is, I should have brought this one up first. Let's see if I can pull this one off here. Well, it's coming. All right, here we go.
The perils of modern technology. Let's take a look.
Yeah, I'm getting better at this thing. All right, have you got them up on your screen right now?
Yeah, no, they are definitely there, and they do look nice. I mean, the glitter pack's a little bit different, I suppose.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's like a dazzling galaxy design. The one thing about that you've got to say is, in terms of CR7 releases, this one is probably one of the best. I mean, this is no Safari pack, you know, with that terrible two-tone design.
The Safari pack was one of those weird ones, like the original Safari pack, obviously, they did, where in my younger days, it was kind of... I thought it was all right, but now as I've gotten older, it's not as good. I mean, this is the most, I suppose you could say, the most normal sort of CR7 release.
Yeah.
Sort of colorway-wise. I mean, I personally could do without the giant shock of CR7 on the instep of the boot, but that's I'm not going to get my way there. It's his boot. So.
Yeah. I mean, I like the Vapor version as well. I'm a big fan of Vapor over the Superfly. I think they look pretty nice as well. Ideal for players that like twinkle feet, right? Because they got that twinkle effect.
Oh, yeah. No, that's exactly it. If you'd like to dance, put on those shoes and dance. I'd say dance the blues, but they're not blue, so I can't use a David Bowie reference.
Hey, you. And he did a good job with them this weekend. Not David Bowie, but Ronaldo. I mean, it's impressive. He had an impressive performance in El Clasico. So,
as he always seems to come out for El Clasico.
He does, doesn't he? To be honest, I mean, that's kind of boots. I'm gonna pull up that image that we had a second ago of good old Cristiano dribbling. I want to know what you think of the ball in this image.
Are you able to zoom it in for me a little bit or no?
Zoom in just a little bit.
It's a
little bit blurry, but.
That ball for me isn't there.
No, I mean, it's not there, right?
It's not the right shadow.
Yeah, and I do realize that Ronaldo likes to run with his head up, but there is no way he's coming into this ball looking to dribble away. It's a Photoshop job, right?
No, it has to be, because if he's coming in the way he's coming in, he's going to plant his foot just to the right of that ball, and he's going to end up belting it with his left as he strides through.
Yeah. He probably scored doing that as well, though. I mean, it's Cristiano Ronaldo, so.
Yeah.
It was strategically placed there by Nike because the Ordem, the high-vis ball designed for winter, was released in the three big European leagues this past weekend. As La Liga, EPL, and Serie A. So it is strategically photoshopped into this image. I know it is. Controversial, but it's the way it is.
That's guerrilla marketing.
It is. In terms of the ball itself, a lot of technical speak on this one. Nike have said it took 6 years for them to develop this one, primarily because it is the first fuse welded ball. So there's no glue in this ball or different segments. It's all one ball. So interesting to know.
That's an interesting, which kind of throws me for a loop, because are we saying that, like what is fuse welded? Is that one of those sort of corporate-y buzz words, or is there going to be more paperwork coming to it to explain it?
I think it's marketing, man. I think that's where they got the ball, and they got this little fire thing and just like melted the ball together.
Okay. So it's so it's a bladder inside another bladder, pretty much.
That's it.
Okay.
You should design soccer balls for Nike.
That's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna send in a design idea. There'll be no visible weld marks or anything. It'll just be a perfect sphere.
Yep. All right, next.
It's a nice looking soccer ball. I'll give it that much. Color wise,
it is. We're moving on to the new Puma evoPOWER, which should be up on your screen right now, I'm hoping.
Yep. You are up there. The Puma evoPOWER in the Miami Vice pack colors.
The Miami Vice pack. You know what?
Don Johnson should be there. Well, where is Don Johnson? Why is he not advertising those boots?
He's the guy in the goals.
Oh, he's the guy in the goals? Oh, yeah, that's fair enough.
Strategic marketing, you know, strategic placement by Puma.
Mm-hmm. No,
they just do it a little bit different than Nike. They actually like just put feet in instead of the entire person or ball object.
Okay, I get you. Yeah, that makes more sense. I mean, it's not a leisure suit, but it'll have to do. So color wise, I like it.
You like it? Are you gonna put yourself in a pair of these boots?
Yeah. No. If I would. I wouldn't mind it. But you know, they are. It's different. It's those coral colors.
And they we got
stuff.
Giorgio right here.
Ah yes, the man whose name I can't pronounce. So I just refer to him as the guy who got bit by Suarez.
He is that guy, right? He is the guy. It's either Chiellini or Chiellini. I think it's Chiellini. I'm gonna ask the viewers right now, because I'm sure we've got some Italian viewers, to hit up the comment section and let us know if it's Chiellini or Chiellini.
Or is it Chiellini?
Chiellini. It's not even Chiellini or Chiellini. It's Chiellini. That's it. We got it. If you want to comment down below, don't put in the comment. We got it. Our English, Canadian, Italian guy here got it.
Oh, wonderful. Look at that. That's the only foreign name I've pronounced right in about the last 12 years.
That was perfect. You did it really well. I'm heavily impressed. All right, what other images have we got to pull up right here? We got, from El Clasico this weekend.
Oh, here we go.
We got, this is not your Nike or your Adidas or your Puma. Instead.
It's the double diamond.
The double diamond. Made their way into El Clasico and managed to score a goal, which is heavily impressive. It's nice to see another brand other than the big three getting involved, right?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's you remember like 10 years ago when Nike was a Umbro was a fixture of El Clasico for it was about 12 months when Michael Owen was there.
Michael Owen,
But then if you go back further than that, when everybody was wearing Umbro boots, so...
Yeah.
Back in the day, and those were the days.
Those were the days. And you can see James beside him. James?
Is James... Oh, James is not sporting the Crazy Light pack.
He is wearing the Y3s, so he's still... Adidas are obviously still trying to push them. It's funny, it's one of those releases that... You know, it's so unique, and you expect it to be extremely popular, which it probably was, but it's a boot that hasn't sold out just yet, so they're still available.
Well, Are they the? Do they retail at the same price as what the Crazy Light rolls for? If I remember.
Yeah. Are they up about 300? They're in the 200s. They're in the mid 200s. So they're.
Oh, okay. So they dropped them down a little bit. Because I know the Y was it the original? Is it Yamamoto who does it?
Yes, Yamamoto. I don't know. It's okay. Yeah, close. The Y3. Yeah. Let's call him the Y3.
Oh yeah, but when he did the other one last season.
That was the Y2.
The Y2. What was the Y1?
The Y1 was the Lion. Do you remember like the old school, like maybe 7 or 8 years ago? It that featured a line, just a plain old ordinary line on the boot.
No, I don't remember.
That's kind of like older school.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, they were remarkable. You can find them. You can find like posts on them and images about them every so often. It's here or there.
I'll have to take a look for that to see what that looks like. But yeah, no, that's that. I remember last year when they did those, they were retailing at about $300 or something like that, US, for the Y2s. So if they've knocked them down to $250, they should probably sell a little bit better.
It's it's nice to see more limited edition boots on the market, but from when we had the initial GS, the Greenspeed, was the first authentic limited edition. Everybody wanted them, hit the market. They went mainline in media, which was really nice. And then we had the Greenspeed 2. And gradually it's turned into every 2 weeks we have a new limited edition.
No, I mean, that's just one of the downfalls.
I like the every 6 months, you know. So maybe we have a on-off Nike Adidas war. And Puma in between. Puma do a good job with their limited edition as well.
No, I don't. Well, Puma are probably the best at it, just based on the fact that they're not releasing one every, fortnight or so.
Yeah. So, speaking of unique boots, the next one I want to pull up really quick. This one by Darren Dunn, and I posted about this on the website. If you're watching this live, you can find it on the website right now. If you're watching it tomorrow, whenever, I'm going to leave links down below.
It'll still be on the website. If you're watching it tomorrow, it's not going anywhere.
The website, I hope so, if the website is still up. Darren Dunn created these custom boots. These ones are going to be presented to Pelé. He hand-painted them. He's a Kuria's artist. He's involved in Aboriginally Design in Australia. And he did a really good job with these, as he does with all his boots.
No, he does. He does a fantastic job. I believe it was when you did the article, we were talking about those last on the weekend, and I said that, you know, it'd be nice if, let's say, one of the companies could snap him up and have him do the designs, do the Aboriginal designs for them. But as you said, he's very big into the Aboriginal culture in Australia, so in education, so it would have to be around that sort of an idea.
And that's the thing. He is definitely all about education, and he has certain schools set up in Australia where he has kids come in and learn through the art scene. So I love his work. I love his designs. I always reach out to him before I post his content because he's pretty specific about that. So definitely appreciate him allowing us to share his images. Again, if you want to check out more of his work, you can find it on the website.
Yeah, no, he did a great job with those ones, which we'll be giving to Pelé. He did a great job with the ones that he had last year, which were I believe it's the AFL. At this point, I would like to just quickly throw in, I know they're in the off season, but the two that I wore last week, Go Geelong, home of the Cats.
The Cats?
The Cats, the Geelong Cats of the Australian Football League.
That's awesome. I didn't even know they existed. You just educated me right there.
I do what I can. I have to bring the high brow. I got to bring the brow level of the show up. So, a little bit of education.
A little bit of education. Any other boot spots for us? What do you got for us?
What do I got? I mean, we have Carlos Tevez still sporting his poorly blacked out Nike Tiempos. On the Nike Tiempo front, former Umbro guy Eric Dyer, the guy I love for fantasy soccer for the first couple of weeks.
First 2 weeks, and then he got
benched for a couple of weeks, but still. Has moved possibly from Umbro. He was spotted wearing the Nike Tiempos as well, blacked out.
Oh, say it ain't so.
And that's unfortunately his third boot of the season. He started out with the UX1, moved over to the Speciale when they released the new colorways for the Speciale, and now potentially Nike. So Nike loses one.
Nike gains one. Umbro loses one.
Oh, sorry, Umbro loses one. Yeah, where am I going?
Speaking of Umbro boots, I just finished checking these guys out. As you can see, they're a little bit muddy. This is the GeoFlare that was released during the summer for the World Cup.
Okay, that's the... Is that the actual World Cup colorway? It says...
This is the version that they had players wearing in the World Cup, that camo design.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it's a little bit unusual because, like, on soccer.com, you'll find the GeoFlare listed, but it's a different style boot. It's the one that has that, like, sandpaper design on the forefoot. And that's kind of like the original concept version of the boot. It kind of has that material that's like the Geometra, where the Geometras were.
Yeah, no, it's the sandpaper sort of.
Yeah, so this version right here is their current version, currently not available in the U.S. So I checked them out, tested them. I like them, but they're a little bit sturdy. The material in the upper, it is a synthetic, but it's...
No, it doesn't have a lot of give by the looks of it.
No, it doesn't. I mean, the sole plate itself is pretty flexible. You know, they're listed as a control boot, which is primarily due to that material. But for me, they're a complete power boot, man. They've got that like power element, that they're a solid, well-built boot that you can strike shots with and you don't take in the impact. So I'm going with, I put it on the website, there's a feature up on them. For me, these are a power boot, not a control boot, even though they don't have anything along the strike zone. It's just the construction of the boot and how full-bodied they are.
Oh, wow. So Umbro is quickly becoming the brand of the power boot. We have the Geometra, and then you have the UX1.
The UX1 is without a doubt the power boot, but it's just the construction of these for me that puts it in the power boot. Flipping them over to sole plate, they've got that unusual configuration. As you can see, they are not really suitable for AG services. So anybody looking for a pair of boots for artificial ground, these are not the boots you're going to want. They're definitely suitable for firm ground, and they are pretty nice in the sense that they give you solid traction when there's rain or wet surfaces. So a little bit of mud, this is a good boot to go for. And that's why I wore them yesterday, Rich. It rained here the weekend. Yes, it rained in California.
It rained again?
Yeah, can you see that little bit of mud?
I see a little bit. Yeah.
So... a boot that I have just received from the folks at ASICS.
Ooh.
Did I tell you? I don't even know if I told you I had these in.
No, you're springing this one on me. It's not on my little scribble list of notes.
You know I like the DS Light X-Fly. Well, they just sent over the synthetic version.
Okay.
So I'm going to get to check these out. Immediately, definitely not going to compare it to the latter version, which I absolutely adore, but everything is pretty similar except for that synthetic upper, and I'm gonna check them out and see how they test compared to that later version.
That'll be an interesting read. I don't even know full stop if there's anybody who in the pro ranks who's been wearing the synthetic over the K leather, obviously.
No, and that's the thing. ASICS don't do a lot of marketing, which is kind of like their downfall. But
yeah.
The DS Lite X-Fly boots are awesome, man. They're absolutely awesome. Specifically the leather version. One of the highlights for me is the inside of the boot, where they have this like suede lining.
Looks nice.
You see that low-cut heel? I'm all about that.
Well, that's because you're the speedy winger.
Speedy winger. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to checking these out. And that's in the works right now.
That's cool.
Your moment of the week, man. Give me your moment.
Let's throw it up. I'm going MLS because I don't talk about it enough. Marco DeVio, Il Grand Marco, as they were calling him in Montreal this weekend, ended his career on a semi-unfortunate note. I mean, he scored a goal in his last match. Great stuff. But the appalling Montreal Impact couldn't hold on for the win, gave up a late goal, 1-1 draw against DC. But Marco DeVio scoring a goal in his last match.
That's a highlight. The guy is a legend.
Yep, got a nice little painting from Issy Nakajima Ferran, who's one of his teammates, who apparently also dabbles in art, and is also a Diadora DDNA 2 wearer.
All right.
That's another one I'll throw in there randomly.
That's a good one.
So what do you have, Brian?
For me, it's the it's not the top moment. It's the end of Chivas USA.
Okay, yeah.
And with that, I want to give a shout-out to my buddy Danny Kennedy, who has been the keeper there for the past few seasons, and he's endured all the problems that they've had. And he's been the constant positive of everything Chivas USA. I think, for me, when people refer to Chivas USA in the future, 10 years, 20 years down the line, I think the first name that will pop up is Danny Kennedy.
I'd agree with that. I mean, he is... No, I said to you earlier on this afternoon was, it's consistently staggered me how he stayed with that team, being on how talented of a goalkeeper he is. He could play anywhere else in MLS.
He could. There was a moment 2 seasons ago where he was on the verge for signing for LA Galaxy. How many people know that?
Not many people know that one, yeah.
A little bit of insight for you, but he was on the verge, and it fell through last minute, and they signed Pineda.
Oh, Jaime Pinedo?
Yeah.
The Panamanian?
Yeah, Panamanian.
Oh, they'd have been better off taking the homegrown boy.
I think so, too.
He's a local boy. They got to take him. But
yeah, so shout out to Danny. He's done a good job there. And he will be part of, a lot of people don't know. Oh, well, Chivas USA today officially stated that they're done, completely done, no longer an MLS side. It will be refranchised with a new team starting in 2017. So what does that mean for the current list of players? Well, that means they're going to be involved in a re-entry draft. And, of course, Danny will be part of that re-entry draft. So where's he going to end up? We don't really know.
Orlando City.
That's a good shout right there. Can you imagine him with Kaká feeding long balls to Kaká? That would be perfect.
That'd be nice. Yeah, I know. It'd work out well. You come into the league, get a top-quality goalkeeper. You have... the most expensive, you have the highest paid player in MLS as of the 2014 season in Kaká playing up front and whoever else they decide to bring in. Odd rumors I've heard are potentially Toronto FC Brazilian designated player Gilberto. That is very, very sketchy details.
Hmm. You're a man of a lot of knowledge, hidden knowledge.
Nope. And regarding Chivas and the dispersal draft, Eric Torres, who has been the only other light at the end of the tunnel.
Dynamic player, and yeah, he's been playing really well.
He will probably not be part of the dispersal draft, because he is on loan from, I suppose you could say, actual Chivas.
The only remaining Chivas.
Yes. Yeah. Chivas now. He is on loan, so if MLS want to include him in that, they have to buy him, and apparently it's like an $8 million buyout clause or something.
Interesting. I did not know that.
And that was part of that is thanks to a wonderful American writer called Yves Galicep, also known as Soccer by Yves on Twitter.
That's the guy. Okay, Rich, let's wrap this up. I'm sure people
right.
are going to have their dinner, drink a beer, watch some football. I don't know what people do in the afternoons. What is your Twitter handle?
My Twitter handle is... Actually, what is my Twitter handle? Hold on a second while I go check.
Rich, you don't even know your Twitter handle.
No, I don't know my Twitter handle.
I didn't mean to spring it on you. I mean...
Yeah, that was... Okay, at Richard L. Wyatt.
At Richard L. Wyatt.
Yeah, there you go.
Because he's a wealth of knowledge and he shares it all on Twitter. And mine is at SockCleats101, so you can find us there. This has been the second episode of Boots and Bantz. For you guys viewing right now, appreciate having you watching. And I'll be on Twitter for the next few hours if anybody wants to share some feedback. More than willing to listen to your comments. Just make it nice.
No, exactly. Or some boot spots. If you're gonna send the comments, which are nice, send them to Brian. If you're gonna send the hatred, send it to me. I'm a little bit more sarcastic, so it works out better that way.
That's perfect. I like that. That's a great idea.
But other than that, we will be back every Monday.
Every Monday. We'll shoot for 5:30 next week. It was 6:30 this week, so we'll shoot for the 5:30 slot next week. Make sure you guys come back and get involved.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. And for those of you on the East Coast who don't live in California, that's 8:30.
Oh, yes.
To 9:30.
It's perfect timing.
So, yeah, works out.
I've been Brian. He's been Rich. See you guys.
Have a good night.